Welcome to my student generated review of Enthalpy 2. In this lecture, we are going to cover the delta H of your reaction, which is how your energy changes during any given reaction. We'll go over Hess's law, which is a very powerful tool in calculating how this changes over the course of several reactions or just one reaction. And then we'll go over that the principles behind bond energy and how those relate to our enthalpy. I just wanted to start off my review by this quote by Russell M. Nelson that says that education is the difference between wishing you could help people and having the knowledge to enable you to help others. So if you find yourself down in the dumps while you're studying chemistry here at BYU or any of your other rigorous courses, whether you're pursuing a degree in engineering or medicine, or you're just taking this for fun, just try to take a step back. And one thing that helps me is just helping to realize that one day this, what we're going through now, will enable us to be able to help other people, and how to know to best suit their needs. So just keep that in mind. So in this brief review, we're going to cover what enthalpy is. We'll go over an introduction of what Hess's law is and how powerful that is in calculating the change in our enthalpy. We'll go over the three ways to calculate enthalpy, and then we'll practice those three ways, and then that will be about it. And hopefully that is about 20 minutes worth of material. So to start off, what is enthalpy? Professor Mortensen said that enthalpy is just a way to bookkeep. So it's just this way that scientists have developed to keep track of energy change over any chemical process. Simply put, for this class, when we're working at constant pressures, your change in enthalpy or your delta H is equivalent to your heat. And so that's really just the most basic and simplified version. In this class, we don't really have to go over when there's a varying pressure. So the general formula that we use, you can find this on your formula sheet. It's a delta H, which is your enthalpy, your change in enthalpy, which is your final, so your ending minus your initial, right, is equal to your change in energy plus your pressure times your change in volume. And so if you substitute in some subsequent equations from the sheet, you can clearly solve that if your pressure is at a constant, then delta H is equal to your heat. And so enthalpy is a measure of the total energy of a system. So we have this man named Hess. Hess's law. He comes up with this this theory that's called Hess's law. Three S's is what Professor Mortensen said. And it states that if a reaction can take place by more than one route and the initial and final conditions are the same, the total enthalpy change is the same. And so really what Hess did is he applied these principles behind state functions, which is the path is not included in your results, right? It's the difference between your elevation versus tracking your mileage on a road trip, for example, right? And so Hess, what he did is he figured out that the enthalpies of your reaction as a whole relate to the parts of that reaction. And so here in just a little bit, we are going to go over a couple of these applications that we can use this very, very powerful tool in enabling us to keep track of what's happening to the energy in our reactions. And just a couple of fun facts that we have on here that were on defaults, but I just left them just because I think it would spice up this presentation. It's that 1 out of 5 readers appreciate accurate information, and 89% appreciate accurate for information. So basically the same things, but I can't really vouch for what they're saying, other than there's a lot of discrepancy in facts. So make sure that you are making sure you have some good critical thinking skills. And so hopefully my picture isn't covering it like it is on my screen, but we can use Hess's law in three ways to calculate the changes in enthalpies. So the first way is that you can sum up the enthalpies of reaction of multiple reactions to give you a net. And so as we'll see later on, this is very powerful in enabling you to manipulate different reactions and utilizing that information to be able to calculate an unknown enthalpy of reaction. Very powerful. Looking forward to going over some examples there. And that equation is the delta H of your net reaction is equal to the sum of each individual reaction. So we'll go over those applications here in just a bit. So get excited. The second way is you can calculate it using the enthalpies of formation. If you remember that is the enthalpy of formation is per one mole, right? So you have some pure elements summated together to give you one mole. And then from that, you should have an enthalpy of formation value. And so Hess figured out that we can use these to our advantage in calculating the total change in enthalpy of any given reaction if we have the individual enthalpies of formation of the products and reactants. And so what he figured out is that if you sum the moles of each of your products, the delta H of formation of each of your products, and you subtract that from the sum of the moles per each individual enthalpy of formation of the reactants. So you, in essence, simply put, you have the sum of the products minus the sum of the reactants. And we're talking about enthalpies of formation here. The third and last way that we'll go over is bond energies, is that you can utilize the information we have about bond energies and calculate how much energy you have given off from breaking bonds. And you can subtract that from the energy that you have summated from forming bonds. And we use this when we know what kind of bonds are involved. It helps to use Lewis structures to theorize what is going on. And we'll go over that here in a bit. So when measuring enthalpy, there's perhaps hundreds of different ways that we can track, like I said earlier, that your change in enthalpy is really just a bookkeeping method to keep track of the energy that you have that is going on and moving around throughout your reactions. And so as you can see here, Google, if you type in different kinds of enthalpies, you've got 15.2 million results in 0.89 seconds. So a lot of information there, but the most important ones are highlighted in blue here. So you have your delta of H, which is your energy of enthalpy of vaporization. You have your delta H of fusion, which is the enthalpy of fusion, which is the melting of a solid to a liquid. And so we have this question below here that says, what about condensation and solidification? So if you take the inverse value of your delta H of evaporation, you will get condensation. And if you have the inverse of the change in enthalpy of fusion, you will have the enthalpy of solidification. So you just flip the signs on those and it flips the processes. Thirdly, we've got the change in enthalpy of formation, which is just how much energy is required or is given off when anything is formed. So if you remember, we learned in class that diatomic elements, the change in enthalpy of formation is zero because it doesn't require anything. That's the most favorable energy advantage there, is that they would like to be diatomic. So it doesn't take any energy there. So remember that, it can trip you up really easily. The fourth is the delta H of the reaction as a whole. And then fifth, we have the delta H of bond energies, which is your breaking bonds. Breaking bonds always will require energy. and creating bonds gives off energy in favor of energy advantage. So if you remember, the whole reason that two molecules will bond together is to create an energy advantage. And so if you're trying to split that, you're going to have to add energy in to break that apart, and vice versa. Okay, so the first example we'll go over is the sum of your enthalpies of reaction, which, if you remember, is used when combining formulas given enthalpies of reaction. So in this given example, in any problem that you're given, it's common that you'll have a goal equation, something that you're trying to develop from other equations. So you can summate different equations to give you one net equation. And there's just a couple of rules that you have to follow when you're doing this. You can multiply equations by any factor as long as you multiply the delta H of reaction by that same factor. And so this is very helpful that in knowing that per mole, you're going to have differing numbers of your delta H of reaction. So if you need more molecules on either side of your goal equation, I'll call it, which in this question is reaction 3. So if we were to need 2 moles of D, for example, you just multiply reaction 1 by 2. So you'd have 2F as a gas yields 2D solid plus E as a gas that is also multiplied by 2. So that's very helpful. And what that does is that also means that you have to multiply that individual change in enthalpy. You have to multiply that by that same factor that you're multiplying your molecules in that equation by, that mole fraction. The second rule that we'll have here is that the sign of your delta H changes if you flip any equation. So sometimes it's necessary that you have a given equation that needs to be flipped around so that you can have it in the right orientation to match up with your parent function or the goal function. And so how this relates to your delta H of reaction is that if you flip any equation, you have to make sure that you flip the sign of your delta H of your reaction. And so given Hess's law, you summate these reactions. It's important to also know that if you have any molecules on opposite sides of your two equations that you're using to construct that final goal equation, is that those will cancel out essentially. And so you need to make sure that you have the same factors of moles of each of those on either side. And so that's where these rules come into play. And so for this question, we have, what is the delta H of formation of the following equations and delta H reactions? Write an equation for the enthalpy change in reaction 3. And so if our goal here is to get reaction 3, we're going to have to get element D as a solid plus element E as a gas on the left side as, or in other words, as your reactants, right? And so we can see from reaction 1 here that we have your element F as a reactant. And so we're going to need to flip that equation. And so that will give us this flipped, but we also notice that once we flip reaction 1, we're going to have element F as a gas on the product side. But in reality of our goal function, we have element F as a solid. And so that means we need to utilize reaction 2, right? Because Hess's law states that we can add multiple reactions together. And so that means that we're also going to flip equation or reaction 2. And so what this gives us is that, in essence, if you flip any of those equations, remember that second rule we talked about is that you have to flip the sign of the corresponding delta H of any reaction, which will finally give us the delta H of reaction 3 is equal to the negative delta H of equation 1 plus a minus delta H of reaction 2. So moving forward on to the second usage of Hess's law is utilizing the enthalpies of formation. So these are used when given the delta H of formation of both your products and reactants. And one thing that I like to do that really helps me keep everything straight is that if you just look in the problem that you're working on, generally they will tell you or provide you with information that you need. And so if we're given a table in any question that has a delta H of formation of a list of molecules, then it's pretty clear that we're going to be using the second usage of Hess's law. So just really pay attention to what they're giving you, because you can find out really quickly the best way to calculate your change in enthalpy of the reaction as a whole. And so what Hess found out is that if you summate, remember, the moles of your delta H of formation of your products, so you summate all of the products by the proper factor of moles that there are, and you subtract that by the sum of that same process, but of the reactants. And so we can see from this equation right here, the C2H5OH as a liquid plus 3 moles of O2 gas yields 2 moles of carbon dioxide gas plus 3 moles of water as a gas. And so if you remember this equation, so you take the sum of the products minus the sum of the reactants, with, remember to keep in mind the correct number of moles, right? Because any delta H of formation is given per 1 mole. And so if we're summating these, we have to ensure that we have the proper fraction or ratio or factor of these delta H's of formation. And so since in our product side, beginning with the products, we have 2 moles of CO2, we need to multiply the delta H of formation of CO2 by 2. And then we add that to 3 moles of the delta H of formation of gaseous H2O. And then we subtract that number from the 1 mole of your hydrocarbon there, plus your 3 moles of O2. But if you remember why this chart has O2 gas having a delta H of formation of 0, it's because it's a diatomic molecule and it's more favorable for it to be diatomic. So it doesn't even require any energy to become diatomically bonded to another oxygen. And so if you do the math here, you make sure that you have all of your negatives straight, you should end up with a delta H of reaction of negative 1,234.7 kilojoules. And so when you're working through these questions, make sure that you pay attention to your units. Don't get confused when it's joules. Make sure that you multiply by your mole ratios and you'll be just fine. So finally, the last way that we'll calculate the delta H of reaction is by utilizing the energy that we know about bond energy. And so the final way to utilize Hess's law, you take the sum of your delta H of your bonds breaking minus your sum of your delta H of your bonds forming. And so remember that breaking bonds requires energy and forming bonds releases energy, because if you remember, it's more favorable for, if any individual molecules or atoms are going to bond to one another, it's more energetically favorable for them to be so. And so there is a surplus of energy here. So given the following question, we have a very clear and distinct, essentially almost a Lewis structure in the first element that we're given, plus 2 moles of H2 as a gas will yield another hydrocarbon. And so you need to make sure that you think through these. So we have one single triple bonded carbon. And so you look on your chart, you find the energy in kilojoules per mole of that. Since we only have one of those, we just use one. You add that to 2 carbon hydrogen single bonds, which you find that value from your chart. You add that to 2 other, excuse me, I got a little ahead of myself. And then you minus that from your bonds formed, right? And so you make that big old hydrocarbon, you draw it out as a Lewis structure, you'll find that you have 2 centralized carbons bound to one another. And then off of each of those carbons, you have 3 hydrogens, which total in total gives you your 6 hydrogen carbon bonds plus 1 carbon-carbon bond. So if you summate those, you'll get a negative 289 kilojoules per mole. And so that just about does it for us here at BYU. Hope that your finals are going well. If you have any more questions, smash that like and subscribe button. Go follow Professor Mortensen. Let's get him some royalties coming in from YouTube. I wish you the best.